go into the substance, before we dive in into the anything like a content or other things, you guys should have seen the outline that I sent out. I will be sending out this type of outlines throughout the preparation, and those outlines will be complementary to the preparation material that I either sent out or will be sending out or making it available online. So that's the deal. Also, going, and I think this is very important, because we once in a while we do have individuals who are eligible, almost eligible, and I think every time I do come across some individuals who are very smart people, but for one reason or another, they're not qualified. Just by way of example, I had this chat with a clerk of court who works for the judge, and I did my time at the court doing the court stuff. I still go to court sometimes as an attorney, but basically we just went to the Starbucks. That was before COVID, and the gentleman was really interested in taking a customs license broker exam. So my next question was, okay, so are you able to see it? And the answer was, it depends. In that situation, the clerk was working for the federal court, and because he was working for the federal court, he was considered to be the employee of the United States or the federal government. That bullet point three that I put on the screen. Now, had I had a conversation with a gentleman who was working for New York State Court, for example, that would have been a different story. Actually we're good, because we are on the regulation, and we can see that the administration of the exam is in the regulation is prescribed every on the fourth Wednesday in April and October. Okay, unless there is a national holiday, religious observance, or foreseeable event, blah blah blah. All right, so fourth Wednesday. If you guys go in and open up the calendar, let's say, and I'm just going to open any calendar for 2021. All right, so this is 2021. We see that April, the Wednesday number one, Wednesday number two, Wednesday number three, and Wednesday number four, right? So the regulations do say this is done on the fourth Wednesday, right? Which, logically speaking, is 28th, which is the Wednesday number four. But let's go to the notice of examination. So this is cbp.gov. If you can see, you have explicit statement that says April 21st, 2021. If you do go back to the calendar and you check the calendar again, you can see that the Wednesday of 21st of April is the third Wednesday, not the fourth Wednesday. So welcome to the world of customs. All right, now going to the exam materials. All right, so I posted, notice the link, and so everyone is on the same page. I'm going to put it in the chat too, because I just updated the stuff. The stuff which have been updated with the links does include the HTS, the Title 19, of the CFR, which you need to have, the and miscellaneous stuff, right? The instructions for the entry summary, directives, and ACE stuff. So let's spend a little bit of time on that, because we need to know how we should prepare. So one of the things that we need, basically, the idea is the same, the HTSUS. So notice here, once you open it up, if you are cutting it close, so this is a 5 inch, so if it was a 4 inch, it would be cut very close. It's very difficult to flip the pages because it's cut to the top. That's number one. Number two, if you're going to use inserts, for example, you're going to use annotations, so you break down the HTSUS into, let's say, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, etc., you're going to use stuff. So in this case, I use Manila folder, which I cut up and hole punched. This is extra space. So yes, technically you do have about 8 inches of space which you can fit in, but in reality you're going to need more. So 2 5-inch binders for HTSUS if you're going to use the binding option. The book also contains the chart, and the outline contains the charts. What's very important to know about these charts is the reason why they're there. So this is something new. This wasn't before this particular class. And this chart relates to the check sheet, which I recommend to implement and use it as a part of the practice and ultimately at the exam. So here is the reason. So I received the phone call from one of the examinees who took the exam, which was online, but was very much certain that the answers she provided were not the answers that were taken by the system. In other words, there was some kind of systemic glitch. And my next question, my response was, all right, so are you sure about that? And the answer was, yes, I'm sure there was, the system did, I said for answer choice, let's say 20, and just hypothetically speaking, I said A, but the system put it in as B. I said, well, hold on a second. So I do know that there were system issues before, because we live in the electronic world. So for example, even today we had issues with audio sound, for example. And so this is something which is inescapable. But the question is, how do you correct it? And how do you know if there was a system issue? And moreover, how can you prove that? Let me go back to this check sheet. So so from my experience, this is what we have. We have number one, we have non-evaluation questions right there, and non-FTA CFR. So we're talking about the Code of Federal Regulations, which is straight up, you either know it or you don't, but you know how to look it up. I'm talking about stuff like, what is the CBP form number that you can use? What is, how many days from the date of entry you have to do this, like to file a lawsuit in the International Court of Trade? How many forms of particular document you must use, let's say, to file a protest, right? This is kind of questions which just test your general knowledge on ability to be able to open up this code of federal regulations and answer it, you know. So this is easy stuff. If you know this, this should take you less than half a minute. So those stuff take less time. The next type of question, which can be which heightens the level of complexity, is classification. Classification question, they do involve deliberation, and we'll be spending a lot of time on classification, because some people decide to say, all right, the classification, because many people think classification is most difficult part. I think it's most fun part, because simply there is no right or wrong answer many times. There is a lot of gray area under the rubric of general rules of interpretation. You in that gray mushy stuff, right? So the classification is the next one, because it requires you to reason. It's not just your knowledge, but ability to apply facts to the particular situation. So that's the next one. The next level of difficulty, you have a combination of classification and evaluation. So we're talking about custom designers can give you a form. Let's say they give you the CBP form 7501 and they leave some parts blanked out. And then they ask you, let's say, on country of origin or the harmonized tariff code. But to answer this, you have to know Code of Federal Regulations or the directive or the Form 7501 instructions. So you have to go to several sources, to the HTSUS and to CFR, to get this particular question or set of questions right. So those should be left later, because it would be a pity if you spend all your time on this stuff, but you missed all the stuff which are simple, simply because you run out of time.